All right, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Lake Country Baptist Church. Are y'all ready to praise your Lord and Savior this morning?
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
We'll get y'all to stand up and turn to page 87. Hope you got joy in your heart, because we're going to sing Joy to the World, the Lord has come. We'll sing the first, second, and fourth. Praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning again this morning there at Lake Country Baptist Church. Good to see all y'all. And we are, it's that time of the year, you know, all the junk that everybody's got going on and holidays rolling around. We're a little down, but that's okay. We're here. God's got a message for us. Lord, praise Him for that. And He's here with us. That's even the best part of it. But it is good to see each and every one of y'all this morning, visitors. We don't have a whole lot, but we welcome you. And I want you to come back any opportunity you have to visit with us. Sunday school, as I say, every Sunday morning. Sunday school starts at 9:45. If you haven't been to a Sunday school class, give it a shot some Sunday morning. Get up just a little bit early. Get on in.
Amen.
And come to our Sunday school class, or our Sunday school classes, not necessarily the one I'm in, but come and enjoy. You'll learn. You can study God's Word, and that's where you get fed right there. But anyway, 9:45, our Sunday school programs do start. Don't have but a couple of announcements. Still got calendars. Got the 2020 church calendars. They're free. Taking up donations for the youth. You can pick one up back here in the back. I know a lot of you already got one, but think about it. See Carrie and put a contribution to the youth fund to help them out in whatever endeavor they were going to do. Operation Blanket will continue through December 15th. There's more information on that. On the foyer out there, you can pick up a little piece of paper and it'll give you all the ifs, ands, and buts, what's going on, and partake in that. Next Sunday night, December 15th, there will be a snack fellowship, soups, sandwiches, and sweets. That'll be following next Sunday night's evening service. Any other announcements? Carrie?
About next Sunday night, the youth is going to be like a tiny skit. We don't have a big enough skit to do for the whole service. So if you've got a Christmas song or something you've just been wanting to sing, or any of the little kids want to do something, just holler at me. It's just going to be a lot of fun singing some carols and just enjoying each other. So, but if you have a song, holler at me and let me know.
Everybody hear that? You got a little Christmas song you want sung with the kiddos next Sunday night? I did give it to Miss Carrie. Any other announcements out there? Prayer request?
Janice Hooker. She's having a valve replacement for the 12th of December.
Brother, I want to make this known to this church. Several weeks ago, I asked our church to pray for a lady. I only knew her first name was Peggy. He was a friend of mine's mother. And Peggy went to the doctor and found out she had cancer. And right away her friend called and said, "Would you get those people to pray for her?" I said, "It'd be a privilege." And I'm telling you, they did a chemo treatment. And the first day she went home, she spent all day cleaning the house and helping her husband, trying to make her sit down and rest. And this lady, a friend of mine, called me back and says, "Aideen, you won't believe the difference." And I said, "Well, praise God for it. It can't get no better, I don't guess." Wrong. She called me yesterday and said, "This woman is not a churchgoer, but she was praising God and thanking the Lord. She said, my mother has no pain. She's going about her normal life just like nothing's ever happened." I said, "Well, you know what? Who's responsible for that, don't you?" She said, "I sure do. Praise God for it." And I want to do that right here in front of this church. Those of you that have prayed for her, if you look on the little brochure that we get, there's a name in there that says Peggy. I pray for every one of these people every morning if I can. I don't get busy doing something, as we all do. But I think the Lord knows who Peggy is. Amen. And yes. Right now, no matter what happens, she said, "No matter what happens, I know the Lord has touched me. And I want to go that direction." So y'all pray for her and hope that it just gets completely removed from her body. Amen. And I'm asking that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Linda's
not doing good.
Emily Combs has a little boy. She's having a little bit of difficulties. Combs. No, it's Watson. I'm sorry. She's got married, but anyway. Raymond Morehouse. Is my aunt's brother-in-law. We need to pray for his soul. He never has gone to church, kind of scoffs at Christianity and Jesus. But he's almost to the point of being in hospice now, and she asked me to put him on our prayer list. He lives up in Minnesota, but that doesn't matter.
God's in Minnesota too?
She can pray that somebody will come into his room and God will touch him.
Amen.
Jeff Gilkison, he's in for a big change. They started him on dialysis the other day. So.
George spells his last name.
GILKASON.
That's right there with Hunter.
Y'all go ahead and keep Helen on your prayers. I asked prayer for Helen and Mark last week. Helen has got some aneurysms. She's got two aneurysms going on right now, and her heart's only producing about 30% of what it's supposed to, and it's got the boys pretty upset about what's going to happen to their mom, and the doctor had them pretty worked over yesterday, and Mark had to call and talk to me, and I had to kind of talk him down, let him make him realize that God's in control no matter which way she goes.
Amen.
He's
Amen.
Still in control, and he settled down, and it took him about an hour for him to really settle down good, but they really need our prayers right now. And they're in West Virginia, by the way.
Done.
Keep my daddy on your prayer list, please. He's doing so much better. Sat up yesterday for 3 hours and asked for a Dr. Pepper.
Praise God.
I'm telling you.
Florine Owens, she has throat cancer. She's going through a lot of what that father's been going through.
Just keep Paul Baker on there, please.
Pardon?
Paul Baker.
Anyone else? German? Would you let these people up, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today and we just ask that you take care of these people, folks that have been mentioned, healing, do what you need to do. We all know either way the outcome, it's your way.
Amen. We'll get y'all turn page 103. Page 103, we're going to sing Away in the Manger.
Thank you. praise the Lord, everyone.
Hallelujah.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord today, and I'm glad that you're in the house of the Lord today. And you know what? God knew you were going to be here today. You might not have known it, but he did. Amen. The Lord knows a lot more than we give him credit for. He sees everything. He hears everything. He knows the heart of every man, woman, and child. He knows you even if you don't know him. Amen. He knows who you are. He, matter of fact, whether you know it or not, with the day you were born and you became a living being, he already knew who you were. He already knew what your name was going to be. He already had given that you your soul. And one of these days, that soul is going to go back to him. And he's given us this lifespan, this thing we call life, to make a preparation to go to be with him one day.
Amen.
And y'all, I'm going to be honest with you. There's a lot of people that aren't prepared to go. There's a lot of people that's not prepared to stand before him. But regardless of whether they're ready or not, one of these days, that's going to happen. Amen?
Amen.
And what you do in this life determines what's going to happen to you in the next life. If you're saved, you're going to enter into glory. But if you're not saved, folks, you're going to burn in hell.
Amen.
That's as blunt as I know how to put it to you. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you will burn in hell. And there's no ifs, ands, and buts about it. It's not something I want to see anybody do, and it's not something God wants to see anybody do. The Bible says that he's not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to him. Because he's made provision, he's done all he can do, he has given us his only begotten Son, who was not only born in a manger, but he died on a cross. And he did not die in vain. He died for the salvation of every man, woman, and child on this planet, regardless of nationality, regardless of color, regardless of financial background, regardless of what state you're in. He has come to die for all of us. He has died for all of us. And salvation is available to each and every one of us because of that. But you must make that decision for yourself.
Amen.
No one else on this planet can make a decision whether you're going to receive Christ except your own self. And that's why God's invitation that we're going to have at the end of this service is always come to me. And if you don't come to him, it's at your own peril and your own risk. Amen?
Amen.
It's at your own peril. And that's my first sermon this morning. The title of the message this morning is called Help. Help. If there's one thing we need today, we need help from Almighty God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Psalm. Psalm chapter 12. I'm going to read a single verse. I was studying this psalm this week in my daily Bible reading. And I was, I'm going to be honest with you, preachers get down in the dumps too. Y'all know that? And you know what? I grin all the time. I do. Well, most all the time. But that grin don't mean there's not things going on in my heart and in my mind.
Amen.
That grin don't always mean that I'm happy. Amen? But let me tell you what. You know why I grin all the time? Because the Lord has given me something that no one can take away.
Amen.
And no matter what's going on in this life, no matter what's going on in everybody's life around me, I still have joy in my heart because I have Christ in my heart. Amen? Well, if that don't make you grin and smile, nothing will. And I had to constantly remind myself, Lord, I've got you. Lord, you're in my presence. Lord, you're with me right now. Lord, we are in this together. You'll never leave me. You'll never forsake me, no matter where I'm at, in the hospitals, in the nursing homes. It don't make no difference. He's there. Mm-hmm. Amen? He's an ever-present help in our time of need. We need to remember that this morning. Psalm chapter 12, verse 1. Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth. For the faithful from among the children, the faithful fail from among the children of men. Father, bless this reading of the word. Bless this word into our hearts and help us to realize, God, that without you, we have no help. Without you, we have nothing. Without you, we are nothing. But with you, Lord, we have all we need. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You know, when it seems that there's no hope left in the world, when it looks like no one cares at all about you, when it looks like the world is going to hell in a rocket ship. They're not in a speedboat anymore. Amen. They're in a rocket ship. When it seems like sin and corruption and evil are winning all the time, when you feel like every step forward leads to 10 steps backwards, I mean, it felt that way. No matter what you do, it seems like it's never enough. When you're down and you can't get up, when it appears that only that godly men have ceased and that their faithfulness has failed us all, when it seems that way, that's the time when we need to cry, "Help, Lord." When's the last time you just let all that out and said, "Lord, help me. Lord, I need your help. I need you to soothe this crazy brain of mine. I need you to take all of these thoughts and refocus my attention on what's really important in this life. I need to focus on you, Lord, because without you, I can't do anything. Without you, I'm nothing. Without you, I can't resist the devil. I can't resist evil. I can't overcome anything. I can't heal anybody. I can't save anybody. But Lord, I need your help. I need you." Have you ever done that? No, it's time we did. It's time for us to cry help, because the Lord is there to help us. But we have to allow that to happen in our lives. We can't give the world credit about everything. We can't give the church credit. We can't give the preacher credit. We can't give it. We need to give all our credit and glory to God.
Amen.
Amen. Because He is the one who can help us. He's the one that's willing to help us. And let me tell you what, there's an old worldly saying that if you don't help yourself, you're probably not going to get a whole lot of help.
Amen.
Amen. And the Lord wants you to help you, but He wants you to cry out to Him, believing. Cry out to Him, "Help me, Lord." Moses, of all the people in the Bible, had this great task of leading millions of people across the wilderness to a promised land. It was a task that he accepted begrudgingly, but it was a task that the Lord God gave him the power and the ability to do. And God was always with him. God always stood up for him. He always stood up for God. And he made a mistake one day, and he did something God didn't ask him to do. He did it the way he wanted to do it, and he paid a price for that. Mm-hmm. The price he paid for that was he was going to be not be able to walk across the Jordan River to the promised land. That was the whole purpose of his life and his calling. But God took that away from him because of one mistake that this man made. And if anyone would have had a reason to be grudgingly angry at God, it would have been Moses. But you know what? That wasn't who Moses was, because he knew that the God of glory was his God, his Savior, his leader, his King. He knew that he had done wrong. He admitted that he did wrong. And you know what he could have done? He could have looked at those children of Israel that were poised on the Jordan River that day. He's already an old man. He asked the Lord to let him go anyway, and the Lord said no, and he let him go up on a mountain, and he said, "Just look across. I'm going to let you look at this land. But Moses, you're not crossing that river because of your disobedience to me." It would have been easy for Moses to turn on those people and looked at them and said, "Look, it's all your fault. If it wasn't for all the murmuring and the complaining and all the stuff that you did and all the sin and it had made me angry like you did, I wouldn't be in this boat right now." But that's not what Moses did. But that's what we do.
Amen.
Yep. Preach it. Amen.
That's not what Moses did. That's what we do today. We want to blame everybody for everything. We want to lash out, and we want to blame people for what's going on in our lives. We want to blame people for what they're not doing that we think they ought to be doing. We're going to have to quit doing that kind of junk and cry help.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We got to cry help. We got to cry help, Lord, because He'll give you the right attitude. Moses didn't have that attitude. And so listen to what he said before he died to the children of Israel that he could have blamed for his situation. Look at what he said in Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 29. This is what Moses said. Happy art thou, O Israel. Who is like unto you, O people saved by the Lord, the shield of thy help? And who is the sword of thy excellency? And thine enemy shall be found liars unto thee, and thou shalt tread upon their high places. He looked at them, and instead of complaining to them about what situation he was in and blaming them, he decided to praise God to them. He decided to tell them how lucky they were, how blessed they were, because they were God's chosen people. Y'all, if there's anything I can impart to you for this Christmas holiday, is how blessed you are.
Amen.
To know Jesus Christ.
God.
Amen.
Amen.
The greatest gift that you can ever receive is Jesus Christ into your heart and your life. Amen.
God.
The greatest gift. And if you have that gift, you've got a lot to be thankful for. You got a lot to be blessed and thankful for. Moses, he could have blamed those people, but he didn't do that. Amen. He told those people, he said, he is your shield of help. He is the one that is your, he's excellent to you. And then he gave them a warning to go with it. You know what his warning was? The enemies that you're going to face, the enemies around you. Now, they were fixing to go into war, where they were going to have to go in and they were going to fight hand-to-hand combat and there was going to be lots of death. But that's not what he warned them about. He warned them about this. He said, all of your enemies around you are going to be liars. Did you hear that? Did you know the greatest enemy we face today in this nation as a Christian people is the liars around us?
Amen. Amen, brother.
They lie, and they lie until somebody finally believes it. Amen?
Amen.
And if we're not careful, we'll start listening to the lies and the subverted gospel around us, and we'll fall for it hook, line, and sinker.
Yep.
And y'all, he gave this warning to Israel. And before the fighting was done, they had already succumbed to these lies that they were going to be surrounded by. We have to be careful because God is our help. As long as we cry out to Him, as long as we follow Him, as long as we stay in His Word, as long as we stay on our knees, as long as we keep our focus on Him, things are going to be better in our lives. Does that mean that sickness is not going to come?
Mm-mm.
Does that mean death's not going to come?
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean financial hardship's not going to come?
No, it don't.
Does that mean that you're not going to watch your loved ones die? No, don't mean that. Does that mean nothing bad's ever going to happen to you? No, don't mean that either. But let me tell you what it does mean. No matter what you face, He's with you.
Amen, amen, brother.
He's right there. He sees you right where you're at.
Amen.
And he wants to help. You know, we've got this lie that's been told to us that when the Lord helps us, He just removes all pain. That He removes all anguish. That He fills our pockets full of money. That we'll never be sick. We'll be healed instantaneously. Those are lies. Are they possible?
Yeah,
they're possibilities. But they're not guaranteed from God.
There you go.
Amen? I don't know why God heals who He does and why He don't heal others. I don't know the answer to that. I just know my part is to pray for that healing, and it's up to Him whether He does it or not.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
My part is to lift you up to the Lord. It's your part to believe Him.
Amen.
And it's your part to cry out to Him for help. Because if you don't, you know what Jesus said? You know why you don't have things? Because you don't ask for it.
That's it.
Amen. It's time that we cried out to God, help. Help us, Lord. Amen. Faithful men That'll fail you. Men will fail you. That's why your faith don't need to be in men. Husbands will fail wives, and wives will fail husbands, and children will fail parents, and parents will fail children. Deacons will fail churches, and preachers will fail congregations. But why? We're all human. We do that. But faithfulness will help you to not fail or recover from failure. You have to remain faithful to the church and to the God of the church. No matter what's going on around you, no matter what you don't like, no matter what you see that other people are doing, our job is to be faithful because God's faithful.
Amen.
Amen. Do we have a perfect church? No. Are we a perfect people? No. But we better be a faithful people. Amen. You better be a faithful people because we need to be faithful. So all of these enemies, these liars, and you know who the father of all lies is? Old devil himself, Satan. He's the father of lies. When trouble comes upon us, sometimes we tend to blame other people for our troubles. How ridiculous is that? Is that something we ought to all do? You know what? Accountability and responsibility is something that's dashed out the window in our society today. It ain't never my fault. It's always your fault. It ain't nothing that I ever did. It's always something you did. I raised my children, and it's your fault they didn't turn out the way I wanted them to. Amen?
Come on now. Or on me.
Yeah. And we have a tendency when things go haywire in our lives, you know what we do? We run from God. We blame the church. We run from the church. And we sit there and have our little pity party that it's everybody's fault. But man, that is the time. You need to cry, help, Lord.
That's right.
I need your help. Amen. Psalm 46:1. Listen to this scripture. God is not the problem for you. He's the solution for you. He's not the reason for your anguish. He's the one that can help you overcome it. Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in time of trouble. When there's no other human being around you, no other friend, there's God.
Amen.
He's always there. And for some reason, sometimes that's not good enough for us. Well, where is everybody? Don't they know what I'm going through? Why isn't everybody just flocking to me and saying, here I am, I'll help you. That's
Amen.
Not the way Break life
it,
works.
Brother.
That's not the way life works. Amen. Yeah, scripture don't stop there. Listen to Proverbs 18:10. The name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower. And what do the righteous do? They run into it and are safe. You won't have, if you've got problems in your life, run to Jesus. If you've got things going haywire in your life, run to the tower that is our Lord. Because the Bible says the righteous run into that tower and they're safe there. Amen? They're safe there. We got to learn to do this. He is our help in trouble, and He is not the source of our trouble. So quit blaming God.
Amen.
Quit blaming the church. Quit blaming people around you. And call on His name. And let him give you the help you need. Amen. He knows what kind of help you need. And it always, it's not always what we want.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Amen. We must all learn to trust God, to look at him for our help. Another one of the Psalms. Psalm 21, verses 1 and 2. Listen to what David wrote. He said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, which cometh my help. He knows where his help's going to come from. He knows that if he's going to get help, it's going to come from above. He said, from whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. And y'all, for whatever reason it is, he'll be the last one we ask for help. After we've done exhausted all of our other friends, we'll ask him.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we'll ask God for help, and if we don't get it immediately, we decide he ain't going to help me, and then we go looking somewhere else. How do you think that makes God feel?
Like we don't trust him.
You don't trust him. Amen. You don't trust him. And he knows that. He knows your heart. God knows we need help. He's always known we need help. When he created Adam all alone, remember? And then he looked at Adam and he done created all the animals and the male and female, but he'd only created Adam. And he looked at Adam one day because he knew Adam needed something. You know what he called her? His helpmeet. He knew Adam needed help. So he created a woman to help Adam. And don't get me wrong, ladies, it's a lot more than that. We know that. God went on to explain how much more that was. But it was not good for Adam to be alone. Y'all, it's not good for any of us to be alone.
No, I agree with that.
But in the spiritual realm, it's not talking about the helpmeet that he provided for man. It's talking about himself that helps man. The presence, the ever presence, the non-forsaking presence, the friend that sticks closer than a brother, that's not a human being, that's God.
Amen.
That's our help. He is our help and he wants us to look at him that way. The Lord knows we need help. And y'all, many centuries after Adam, he still knew we needed help. You know how he gave it to us? He gave it to us in a manger. A little baby. What we're celebrating right now, help has come. Amen?
Amen.
So he gave us Jesus Christ. We celebrate Christmas in this great Father's plan. Our help has come. The angels, when they came to the shepherds at night, when Jesus was born, in Luke 2 and 11, this is what the angel said to these shepherds. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Y'all help has come. And you say that in a past tense, it sounds past tense, but help has come and it has never left.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Amen.
Yet because we can't reach out and do this, we think he's not real. But he is.
Amen.
He is very real. Psalm 124 and 8. Psalmist wrote this. He said, our help, listen to this. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Who made heaven and earth. Y'all realize how blessed we are that to live in the time we live in right now? To know the historical facts that we know today? To be privileged to the Word of God that has been put in a book for us. to be able to read, to be able to study, to be able to know the truth of what God has done through the ages for mankind, how God has offered himself, how God has loved man like we don't deserve, how God, the whole story is right here. And not only the whole story till now, but the whole story that is to come is all in this book. But you know what our greatest privilege is? The one that David would love to know. The one that Isaiah wrote so much about, but he didn't get to know it. The one that Jeremiah and Ezekiel prophesied about, that, well, they know him now. But they didn't meet him in their lifetimes. And here we are today. We know that name. We know that name that they didn't know. But they knew they were relying on that name. They knew they could call upon that name. Although they didn't know that name, we know that name. And the name of the Lord is Jesus.
Amen.
And when you call upon that holy name, because the scripture says our help is in that name, our salvation is in that name, everything that we desire from God is in that name. And if you don't know that name, or you don't know the one that is called by that name, then you have no help from God, because he was born your help. He died your help. He resurrected your help. He sent the Holy Spirit back in his name to help. And folks, if you don't have that, you don't have help. And you can blame everybody on this planet that walks and talks and breathes. But until you cry out for the help you need, you're just wasting your breath.
That's right. Amen.
Because without Jesus, you ain't got no help.
Amen.
If you rely only on this world, you are a miserable person.
Amen.
Because this world ain't going to do nothing but let you down. There's a song that was sung, and there's one of the verses to it. It said, it goes like this: our hope is built on nothing less but Jesus' love and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Why did that songwriter write that song? Because he knew what the scripture said, that our help is in that name. And his name is Jesus. My question to you this morning: do you know him? Do you have that relationship with him? Have you cried out to him? Have you been saved by him? Are you following him? Are you walking with him? Is he walking with you? Is his presence with you and never leaves you nor forsakes you? And do you know that? Now, the Bible tells us to call on him while he may be found. Amen. And I'm so glad that he can still be found.
Amen, brother.
But if there's something I want to tell you today, is that you need to cry, help, Lord. You need to seek him for help. Maybe you're here today and you're lost. You don't even know Jesus. Let me tell you what, he's still here.
Right.
And he can be found with you today. But you must cry out to him for that to happen. Would you stand, please? His altars are open for prayer. If you need prayer this morning, please come up. not saved.
Amen, brother.
You're not aware of his presence in your life ever. That the only time you utter his name is in vain, or in violence, or wickedness, where people curse him instead of praise him. He's a word, a name of dirt and trash in your life. And you think people who know him are silly and dumb for believing what they believe. I used to be one of them people. I used to ride by the churches on Sunday night and see those people standing out in front of them, and I think, how ridiculous that these people waste their time. I'm out partying, I'm having a good time, I'm drinking, I'm having a great time. What's wrong with those people? They're not having any fun. I used to say that myself. Did you ever say that? Do you say it now? And then something happened. I met him. I met Jesus. I didn't walk up to him, shake his hand, do anything like that. I went to an altar and bowed down. And there he was. As real could be. And he took that heart of darkness that had no light in it, and he helped me. He saved me, forgave me, and he's walked with me and been my friend and constant companion ever since. If you hadn't had that experience with him, the only way you'll get it is by his invitation. And his invitation to you and to every other person is simple. Come. Come. And when you come and bow down, you'll know what I just told you about. You'll understand it. Because he still saves. He still pours out his spirit. He still speaks. He still listens. One of these days, that time of invitation is going to be over with. And you're not going to be able to walk to an altar anymore. You're not going to be able to call on his name like you could and can now. It's going to change. I can tell you right now, you're not going to come when it's easy, you're not going to come when it's hard. Please don't wait. Still people coming to the altar.
you all, thank you for being here today. And I hope before this week is over with that you find you a place and just cry out to God.
Amen.
If you need anything from him, cry out to him. Let him know. Amen. You know what the biggest issue with most of us is our own selves. My prayer all the time is, Lord, change me. I would love to say, Lord, change Sam. Change Gene. Change AD. Change Bubba. That don't work with God.
Amen.
But when I say, Lord, change me, that all works with God. Let him show you what's there that ought not be. Remember what David wrote? He said, search me, Lord. Try my reins. And if you find something in there that ought not be, Lord, help me get rid of it. That ought to be our prayer every day. Search me, Lord. Whatever's not pleasing to you, help me to cast it away. Thank you for being here today. Don't forget our service tonight. Don't forget the announcement that next Sunday night, the youth are going to do a little concert or play or some sort of little old thing. I don't know what it's going to look like yet, but I do know this. After the service, there's going to be a snack time. And I know that there's going to be some white chili. Well, there better be. Where that is. Yeah, there better be some white chili. There's going to be soup and sandwiches and all kinds of goodies. So y'all remember that next Sunday night. So just bring whatever you want to, and we're going to enjoy a time of fellowship and celebrate the birth of Christ after next Sunday night service. But before then, we have tonight service. Amen. So be back tonight. Service starts at 5 o'clock. And yeah, I still ain't got all this crazy in my brain. 5 o'clock.
Amen.
Come and join us here. We love y'all. Thank you for being here. Visitors, thank you for being here today. If this is your first time, I hope you were blessed, and y'all make sure and speak to everybody that's a visitor here and everybody else too. Brother Kenneth Rachel, would you just mention?
Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity to be here, Lord. This is where we all need to make a connection to you, Lord. We can make our connection through prayer, Lord, but we seem like we can get it out easier with when we're with people that we know and people that we're around and that are more Christ-like, Lord. We just want to thank you for everything you're doing in our lives and bring us back tonight, Lord, and make us where we can understand everything that Gary has to bring to us tonight, Lord. We want to thank you for everything you're doing, Lord. Amen.
Amen.